I'm teaching you about optionals. I'm going to show you four different ways to unwrap them. We're going to talk about optional chaining, and then I'm going to show you some examples of how these are used in a real code base. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. An optional in Swift is something that can either have a value or be nil. For example, our app could have a user object where the age is optional, and that's because in our app, we don't require the user to enter their age, but they can if they want. So our code needs to be able to handle both situations. Hey, is the age actually going to have a value, or is it going to be nil? And that's what this question mark denotes. A good analogy is to think of this age property that has a question mark as a box that's closed. You don't know if that box is going to contain a nil, or you don't know if that box is going to actually contain the integer value of 41. And the way we handle that in our code is by unwrapping the optional. So here's our user object that I mentioned before. Let's create a user real quick. Let user equal a user. We'll initialize that with a name of Sean and the age is nil. So the first way we're going to learn to unwrap is with the if let. And I'll tell you about the pros and cons of each of these methods as we go. So for the if let, we can do if let age equal user.age. And you see user.age, age is the optional. You see that question mark down there. So what this means, I'm going to run through this. So when we say if let age, we're creating a new property to store the value in. If user.age has a value, we're going to store it in this variable called age. If it's nil, it goes into the else block because age could be, you know, 41 or it could be nil. So if we have the value here, we can say print users age is, and then we'll print out the age because it has a value. So it'll go into the else block if user.age is nil. So we can now print user did not enter an age. So if I run this, we're gonna go into the else block because look, Sean's age is nil, this user that we created on line 9. That's the user we're using right here. So if I run it, you see user did not enter an age. So now if I change on line 9, my age to 41, and I run it, you're gonna see it's gonna go into line 14, user's age is 41. So this is us unwrapping the optional. Like I said, we don't know if it has a value or not, so we have to handle both situations. If it has a value, cool. And we just did a print statement, but you can imagine there being like a whole 50 lines of code doing whatever you need to do down here, right? We just did a simple print statement. And then else if it's nil, maybe you want to show an error or do something here in the else block. Now, a downside to using if let, again, I'm going to talk about the pros and cons, is you have to use age within this scope. So what it means, if you have some logic, right? Like say you want to do like if age greater than 40, you know, do something. Now you can see we're starting to get pretty nested here. I'm gonna delete this to clean that up with our code. And it can be very hard to read. So if lets, if they get out of control, can lead to this pyramid of doom that you see here. So that is one of the downsides. Now, of course, if you just have a simple, you know, one line of code in here and it's not super nested, great, go for it. But a way to prevent that pyramid of doom is to use guard let, and that'll be the next example. So for guard let, you need to use a function because one of the features of guard is an early exit from the function. So let's create a function called check age, and that takes in an int. And we're basically just going to do an age check. Like if they're over a certain age, we can do something in our app, whatever that is. But we don't know if age has a value, so we want to unwrap that optional. So we want to do guard let age equal age else return. So I'll say print age is nil. So guard, like I said, is good for the early exit from the function because let's say we're doing a bunch of code down here. Like again, like if age is greater than 40, you know, do something. But because this logic relies on there actually being an age, we basically say, hey, if age is nil, just return. Don't even do all this code below. I like to refer to this as like the line in the sand, the guard statement. If the guard statement fails, it's just going to return and none of the code below it will execute. So again, it provides that early exit, which is nice. And it avoids the pyramid of doom because once you have your age variable here, now you can use that within the entire scope of the function. Whereas if let, remember, you had to use it within this scope right here, just the top part of the if statement, and then that could get super nested. But with the guard statement, you can use it in, you know, in the whole scope of the function. Now, something that's new in Swift 5.7, I believe, is this boilerplate of guard let age equals age. You've seen, you know, everywhere if you've been coding for a little bit. Now you can just do guard let age if the naming works out. For example, up here, the naming doesn't work out. I can't just do if let age because we're using user.age. That adds a little extra thing. But in the very common boilerplate example where you have to do like if let age equals age or guard let age equals age, you no longer have to have that same name. It'll just use this variable name that you use there. So let's run this function here, check age, and we'll pass in user.age because that is the, right now it's 41, so it does have a value. Let me actually add a print statement in here. you are old. Let me comment out these print statements so we don't get confused in the console. So we'll run it. Because there is an age, right, it should go past the guard statement, right, because it is not nil. So it should say you are old, right? It went in, age is greater than 40, you are old. Now if I go up to line 9 again here, make my age nil, it's not going to make it past the guard statement. So run it. So basically if age is nil, it's going to go into this age is nil, as you can see here, and then it's going to exit from the function. So this code never even runs in that situation, which of course for us is just one simple little line, but I mean, there could be like network calls, there could be a whole bunch of code that relies on you having a property here. So you can definitely save running all that code if you don't need to. Okay, moving on to nil coalescing. So nil coalescing is great to provide an easy default value. So I can say, let age equal user.age double question mark or zero. So what I'm saying here is, hey, check user.age, which remember up here right now it is nil. I'm gonna comment out all this if let stuff to stop all the errors and stuff. So right now my age is nil. So if I say let age equals user.age, that is nil. So what it does, it provides a default value. It says, hey, if this is nil, here, give it this default value and put that into age. So if I were to print age down here, and let me get rid of these print statements again so we're not confused, run it. Now age is zero, gives me the default value because it's nil. Now if I go up and change Sean's age to 41 and run it, now age is 41 down there. Now I want to go back to what I said, a easy default value. And this is a case where it might not make sense because providing a default value of zero for the age could mess up some calculations or things you're doing in your app. So a place where it may make sense is if you say let name equal, well, let me actually go back up to the user. Let's pretend the user.name now is optional. So see how you can make something optional? Real quick, just add a question mark to the end of it. So now if I do user.name, and you can see when I type in name, it shows that it's optional right here. And then if the username is nil, then I can provide something like not given. So you can see how if you're providing a list of usernames in your app, showing not given when it's nil is a good default value to have versus maybe passing in zero for a default age might not work out so well. So again, no coalescing, a simple default value works best. Okay, now let's talk about force unwrapping, which can be a controversial topic. Let me show it to you and then talk about it for a second. So I can say let age equal user.age. You can see that is optional. And I can just say bang, exclamation point. What this means is, let me comment that out to not be confusing here. What this means is basically it's forcing the unwrap. Even if it's nil, act like it has a value. And this will lead to crashes. So let me do print age and let me make age nil up here. So age is nil. And I basically said, let age equals user.age. If it has a value, hey, smooth sailing, it'll work. If it is nil, your app's gonna crash. So let's run this and you should see the crash. And if you've been coding, you've probably seen this a ton. Fatal error. Unexpectedly found nil while unwrapping an optional value. That means you're force unwrapping somewhere and it's biting you in the ass. You don't want to do that. Now, many developers will say never, ever, ever force unwrap. And to be honest with you, if you're a beginner just learning, that is probably the safest way to go. Never force unwrap. However, as you get more experienced, it does become a little more nuanced. And I believe 95% of the time, never force unwrap. But there are certain situations, which I'll show you in my code base, where it's fine to force unwrap, at least in my opinion. But again, there are many people that will say to never force unwrap. So you'll hear that a lot. Okay, let's comment this out so we can stop the crashes. And let's talk about optional chaining to finish this off. So this is when the entire object is optional. So let's say my name and the age are not optional, but the user itself is optional. So let's dive into that here. So we'll say var optional user. Is of type user, but I put the question mark after that. So the whole user is optional. Maybe the user of our app doesn't even have to create a profile with a name or an age. So if I want to say let name equal optional user dot name, you see it fills in the question mark right here. So that means the whole user itself is optional and not the name. So what will happen is if optional user is nil, the name will be nil. This automatically makes this property here on line 53 called name an optional. So this is called optional chaining because you're really after the name, but the whole object isn't optional. And then of course you can unwrap this in the typical ways, right? We can do some nil coalescing, you know, not given, that'll work. So name will be not given if optional user is nil, you know, or you can say if let new name equal optional user dot name, say print new name. So this just shows you what chaining is. Again, once you understand the chain, you can unwrap it however you want using no coalescing, force unwrapping, guard let, all the stuff that we've just did. But just so you know, if the object itself is optional, Then to get to the properties on them, you're going to see optional chaining. Now let me show you examples of these in a real code base to give you a little more context. So here's an example of if-let where I'm checking the cache. So on this screen, the avatar, the channel name, and the number of subscribers up top here, I am caching that information because what was happening, every time I went to the screen, it was fetching the data and the UI would flash like as the new data fetched. So I didn't want that. So I wanted to show the older cached information because the avatar and the channel name don't really change and the subscriber number might change every once in a while. So basically what I do is I cache the old information and then show the new one once the network call has completed to get the new channel info. So that is a great thing for if let, because if I look in my cache and the cache is nil, then I just move on and run all the network calls and all that stuff. If I have an item in the cache, then I set my channel info to that cache channel info and update the UI that you see here. And the reason this is good for if let and I'm not using a guard is because I don't really care if it's nil or not, right? Whether it's nil or not, I still want to execute the rest of the code. Whereas if I used a guard, I would have to have an early exit. I would have to return out of the function and I don't want to return out of the function. So you want to use guard when having something be nil makes the rest of the function irrelevant. Here's an example of using guardlet on this screen where I can drag and drop calendar items around. And when I drop them, I want to make sure the day has enough room for it because I limit the number of events in a day. And the date on those objects is optional. So you can see if the date is nil, then I don't even want to do all this other code. So that's a great use for the guardlet. You can see guardlet date equals date. And again, I just haven't updated my old code. In Swift 5.7, I don't need this boilerplate. I can just do guardlet date. But basically, there is no date, just return false, end the function, don't even run that stuff. So again, that's a great use of guard when you want that early exit. Here's an example of nil coalescing, again in this UI, back to that channel header with the avatar, channel name, and subscribers. Like if the channel info is nil, it's another example of chaining, then I want to provide a default value of just NA for the channel name. You can see I use it down here as well. If channel info dot abbreviated subs, that's the subscriber count in the upper right hand corner. If that is nil, or I'm sorry, if channel info is nil, right? Because I get channel info from a network call. So it's nil until I get actual proper data. Then I want to show an NA if that comes back wrong for any reason. And then finally, an example of force unwrapping. Like I said, 95% of the time you should not do it, but here's an example of where I think it's okay. And to be clear, there will be developers that disagree with me and that is fine. But here, this is date math. So this is all Apple system stuff, right? You're getting the year component for today's date and then you're calling dot start. And here I am force unwrapping this date interval. So this is all Apple system stuff. None of this is my code. None of this is anything calculation wise. This is all straight up Apple's stuff. I'm sure there may be some crazy edge case where, you know, this could be nil, but here's the pros and cons of force unwrapping. If you do unwrap your optionals, as you saw in the previous code, you add the if-let, the guard-let, the no coalescing, you start to get a lot of extra code. And you can see here, I'm doing a ton of date math in this app, which is mostly using all of Apple's built-in system stuff. So I would be force unwrapping it everywhere. It'd make my code hard to read. I'm not saying that's a reason to force unwrap. What I'm saying is this to me is one of the examples of a nuanced reason when force unwrapping is okay. If you're preparing for job interviews, you're here learning about unwrapping optionals, a great way to stand out is by having a developer portfolio or developer website. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio, blog, or personal website up and running very quickly. Now I know we're all developers with the skills and the desire to build the web page ourselves. But I would argue there's an opportunity cost to your time. If you're an iOS developer trying to build a great product, a great app, maybe spending a lot of time learning the ins and outs of web development, responsive design, isn't the best way to spend your time. That's why I recommend Squarespace to build that personal website, the blog, your portfolio, or maybe a landing page for your app. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started. They handle all the analytics and the SEO for you. Again, it just saves you so much time so you can get back to doing what you want to do, and that is building iOS apps. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com to start your free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.